And thank everyone for their attendance. We got a lot of great briefings to get on the table today. And Dave, I'll let you go ahead and get them started if you'd be so kind.
Well, thank you, Mayor. We've got 3 hours worth of work to do in 2 hours, so I appreciate the council's attention today and appreciate their willingness to roll up their sleeves and take some pretty serious briefings this afternoon. We're going to begin with a long-awaited update on our modeling and assessment study that the Center for Innovative Transportation Systems from Old Dominion University is going to provide to us. And I'd like to introduce Dr. Mike Robinson. He is the director of the Center of the Innovative Transportation Solutions Center at ODU. His work focuses on the use of computer modeling and simulation techniques to develop solutions in transportation projects with an emphasis on multidisciplinary research. Mike has served as a principal investigator and co-principal investigator for nearly two dozen projects with funding from the United States and Virginia Departments of Transportation, the U.S. Department of Homeland Security, and the Virginia Department of Emergency Management, and multiple local governments. He is the vice chairman of the National Academy of Sciences, TRB Committee on Emergency Evacuations, and a member of the Pedestrian Modeling and Simulations and Cybersecurity Subcommittee. Prior to coming to ODU, Dr. Robinson served as a nuclear submarine officer in the United States Navy, retiring as a Naval Submarine Forces Operations Officer in 2003. And he has been working continuously since day one when we partnered with ODU to set up the SITS and to create our macro, our micro models, and of course to do the Southeastern Parkway analysis. He will introduce his team in his briefing.
Mike, we're glad to have you.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for providing us the opportunity to brief the results of our study on the Southeastern Parkway and Greenbelt. I'd like to begin with a quick agenda, and I'll introduce members of the SITS team, the Center for Innovative Transportation Solutions at ODU, discuss the project history, provide a very quick overview, and then discuss the results of our work. I would first like to introduce Dr. John Sokolowski to my right here. Dr. Sokolowski is the director of Virginia Modeling Analysis and Simulation Center and our boss at SITS. Also here with me today is Dr. Erica Friedland, a simulation specialist at VMAS, and she's also the lead for our new research area into social and transportation equities. Peter Foytek is running the computer. Pete has a background in computer science and modeling and simulation, and he's been the senior programmer at VMAS and the senior transportation programmer for at least 8 years now. And then Mr. Craig Jordan, a professional engineer, is also a modeling and simulation specialist. He's now pursuing his PhD at William & Mary University. He served as the project manager on this, coordinated all our efforts and the work that's done back and forth between us and the City of Virginia Beach.
Well, we welcome everyone. Glad to have you all here today.
The Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt was first envisioned by Virginia Beach and Chesapeake in the early 1980s. As a way to move people back and forth between the coastal areas of Virginia Beach and the inland communities. In 1989, a draft environmental impact statement, or EIS, was published, and in 1994, supplemental documents were also provided. A major investment study was completed in 1996, and as a result of that study, FHWA suspended their participation, citing a need for increased public support. Virginia Beach and Chesapeake continued to pursue the SEPG. In 2006, a final EIS was submitted for approval, and in 2008, gained approval from FHWA. However, in their approval, FHWA told the city not to release the documents publicly yet. And that was because there was a disagreement on the approval, and in 2009, that approval was rescinded by FHWA, a decision that Virginia Beach appealed but was unsuccessful in doing so. The criticism on the work that had been done, criticism of the SEPG as a whole, revolved around the perceived damage and disruption to the wetland areas in Virginia Beach, and the criticism of the initial proposal made was that there had been an inadequate investigation of alternative network configurations, meaning they thought that perhaps the same benefits could be achieved by adjusting the existing city network. When the city came to us and asked if we could pursue this further, we said that to do so would require a dynamic simulation, And we took that on with specific objectives to simulate the network both in 2012 and as forecast in 2034 without the SEPG, then add the SEPG and compare the performance of the network under the different situations and decide whether or not other alternative networks could provide the same level of benefit. We suggested that the city invest in transmodeler simulation software. This is a simulation software that's developed by the Caliper Corporation. Caliper is based in Massachusetts. Their software is very well known. It's designed specifically for traffic engineers and planners. It's relatively easy to use. It's appropriate for both large and small-scale networks. In the model developed and provided to the City of Virginia Beach, we've calibrated it in 15-minute intervals throughout the peak period times. It's useful for smaller platform projects as well, and it's expandable for multimodal use, including public transit. Just as a, oh, by the way, the model that's been provided to Virginia Beach is the second largest in the country right now. Only one in Maricopa County in Phoenix is larger than this one, and it is not. It does not forecast future uses the way this one does. The metrics that we're using for analysis are listed there. The key one is the number of completed trips. Completed trips are those that both start and end between 4 and 6 p.m., and that gives us a standard normalized basis for comparison between the networks. We'll also provide information on the highway capacity manual's level of service, which I'll explain later, and we provide total volumes that are on the south or hourly volumes on the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt at different locations. Go ahead. The 2012 network that we showed or developed for Virginia Beach is shown there. The initial network had 473 centerline miles and 371 traffic signals. Each of those signals is calibrated and set to match the existing signals that are in use today. To conduct this analysis, we had to expand that network further to the west. We included portions of Chesapeake and then a corridor along I-64 as far as Bowers Hill, and then along US 58 as far as the SPSA interchange. That additional area added 40% more centerline miles and 18% more signals to the network. When we built the 2034 network, we added three regional projects that had been approved and were expected to have a significant influence on the SEPG. Those were the south side widening of I-64 all the way to Bowers Hill, including expanding the high-rise bridge, improvements that were to be made to the I-64, I-264 interchange near the Norfolk City line, and then improvements along US 58. And those improvements on US 58 were to provide cross elevation so that there would be no at elevation crossings on the US 58. In our proposal, we said that we would also include any projects that each of the two cities, Virginia Beach and Chesapeake, felt like were likely to be completed and also likely to have a significant impact on the results. Chesapeake asked that we include Dominion Boulevard, including the connections to the Chesapeake Expressway and then on to I-64. Virginia Beach initially asked that we include 15 different projects, but after our August brief, city planning had changed, and they asked that we reduce that to include 7 projects. These are shown on this next slide. The blue dots show the location of the projects that were included, and the red areas are those regional projects. Expanding this network added just 1% in centerline miles, and that's important. We added 1% in centerline miles as we went to 2034. We will add 25% more trips. When we added the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt on this next slide, it's shown in purple there and now in green. That adds an additional 36 centerline miles, 18 miles in each direction. We also added 11 traffic signals that we expected to be completed, and those are at the on-ramps and off-ramps. The demand that we were provided for 2034 did not include the strategic growth areas, but those were approved and the city was moving forward with those during the course of the project. So to incorporate those changes in population and commercial density, we worked with the city and with the Hampton Roads Transportation Planning Organization to forecast the location of new jobs and new residences in 2040 and then interpolated backwards to 2034. With those changes, we came up with a PM peak traffic demand that was increased 25% from the 2012 demand. This next video is going to show some of the intersections, four intersections that are modeled, just so you see the level of detail. Hopefully, you'll be able to see the blue boxes at the intersection. Those blue boxes exactly match the location of the sensors that are used to control traffic signals. At the head of each of those lines, you should see changing red, green, and yellow arrows. Those match the traffic signals. You notice that we've precisely matched the geometry and each of the lane numbers and widths throughout the model.
This is General Booth and Damnick.
And what's the time frame of the?
This is all at 1700. This next one is at Princess Anne in Kempsville.
5 o'clock. Familiar?
No. I don't see the Eagles.
And this reflects your new alignment.
We have worked closely with the city's transportation experts to match the number of cars that are queued to the actual numbers that we see on video. We're available and on the traffic counts. This next one will show the Indian River Kempsville intersection. If you watch closely, you'll be able to see vehicles that move up here and make what's known as a Michigan left turn to go southeast.
Councilman Dyer, you'll see that you'll become very familiar with this as we run this over
and
over.
Oh, I'm sure I'm going to, Colonel.
For the public, but we're modeling what will happen with the new realignment of that intersection.
Is this 2034 volume or is this today volume?
This is 2034.
Okay. What is the Michigan left turn?
See these vehicles that want to go left here actually come this way, get in this lane, and then turn back around and go back down.
Well, in front of the firehouse.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember.
If you're coming southwest here and you want to go to the southeast, you exit off here, get into the leftmost lane, and there's a lane specifically for this, make a U-turn, and then you head back down to the southeast. That's known as a Michigan left turn, and that's in the city's plans.
We have a quick question.
Yeah, a quick question. I don't want to interrupt. Now, Colonel, from what I understand, this is the worst intersection in the city, pretty much.
For congestion.
For congestion and everything. And I think what's critical about this is that the only entrance and exit on 64 is at Indian River Road. That's in Virginia Beach. And then with the development we going on with the Dragas project that comes down Farrell Road, they're really going to need some help in that area, and Linden Haven 11 is also going to help a lot too.
What is it now? City manager, like mine is 60,000. Indian River Road is what?
You stumped me there, Ms. Ross Hammond. Robert Guy, what is the vehicle trips per day through this intersection?
Stumped them all, really.
I tell you what, we'll get you that answer and we'll continue on with this, if this is okay.
Go ahead, let's restart the video.
That's
all right, we'll go to the next slide. That's fine. That's almost the end of this one. And
let's go to the next slide.
The final intersection shows one of the forecast interchanges along the SEPG. This shows where Indian River Road and the SEPG will meet. And this is the source of one of the backups we see in the future, because a little bit farther up Indian River Road, where Elbow Road connects, there is going to be traffic congestion because of the traffic volumes anticipated, and that interchange's backups are severe enough that they would come back to the SEPG and cause some delay there. We also model traffic incidents because they're critical to the city's analysis. The incidents were modeled on historical data provided by the cities of Virginia Beach and Chesapeake, and also by VDOT. We matched the historical records for the frequency, location, and severity of accidents. On roads such as the SEPG, where there is no data to be had, and also for the hurricane evacuation analysis, we modeled the rate of accidents based on an algorithm that was developed at VMASC using primarily vehicles miles traveled, and that's an algorithm that has been shown to be accurate and is been briefed throughout the country. We looked at three accident severities: no accidents, a low rate of accidents, and a high rate of accidents, or high severity of accidents. The difference between low and high is that the higher severity accidents last two times as long as the low severity. This slide shows where the incidents are that were based on historical data in the PM peak period. We modeled 29 incidents in a modeled section of the cities. Between 3 and 7 p.m. During evacuations, we modeled between 35 and 48 incidents, and that's a varying number because there are different scenarios for hurricanes Category 2, Category 3, and different levels of accidents and incidents.
On evacuation, just go back. Did you model using, rather than letting people occupy the evacuation route with cars, but instead, like they did at the end of New Orleans, only moving people out on buses and not letting the cars onto the roadway?
No, and that wouldn't really be an issue in Virginia Beach. If people evacuate as directed in the Virginia Department of Management plans, the level of evacuees is not nearly as high as people think it would be. And the problem is not getting people out of the city of Virginia Beach, it's getting them out of the region.
That's why I asked about the buses, because that would overcome that.
Yeah. This video is going to show you how the accidents and incidents were modeled. If you watch here, you'll see a red vehicle show up, and that's where the accident is shown, and it entirely blocks one lane for the duration of the accident, and you'll see that vehicles back up very rapidly around it. Vehicles are able to merge and move around in the free lane, though, just like they would in real life. It's a quite accurate simulation. Because the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt would be expected to be tolled, we did consider tolls in our analysis. The magnitudes of the toll were determined by Virginia Beach City staff. They based their recommendations on the 2005 HRTPO toll feasibility study and made it consistent with national level guidance. The tolls are assessed based on your entrance and exit location, and the values that were used were 10 cents per mile and a $16 value of time. The value of time is the value that the driver would assess his time were worth if he were going to save it. It's not the same as your hourly wage. The $16 per hour is a very typical value throughout the United States. It's right in the middle of expected numbers. Go ahead. When vehicles make their route choice, whether or not they'd use the tolled routes or arterials, they use what's called generalized cost. And generalized cost is a combination of travel time and the tolls incurred along the trip. You multiply the travel time, which is the sum of the segment travel times throughout a route, and the turning delays that would be experienced by the value of time, and then you add that to the toll. There'll be a couple of examples on the next slide. What we saw was that when we added tolls, it increases the cost to use the toll roads, reduces their usage, and makes the arterials more attractive. This shows the calculation for I-64 as tolled in the SEPG. We assumed that you were able to go 60 miles per hour and had no traffic delays. It's roughly 12 miles along in the SEPG. So you take 12 minutes divided by 60 times that $16 an hour, and then 12 miles times 10 cents a mile, and you get a total cost, generalized cost, of $4.40 for the SEPG route. Doing the same thing, or I'm sorry, for the 264 route. If you looked at the SEPG route, you'd come up with a cost of $6.60 along those sections of road. Go ahead. Our tolling analysis looked at three conditions: no tolls being applied, tolls on both the SEPG and I-264, and then tolls on the SEPG, I-264, and also I-64. When I-264 is tolled, it's 12 miles, and we go from roughly the oceanfront to the interchange at the Norfolk City line. But when I-64 is tolled, it goes from that same interchange all the way to Bowers Hill, although in our comparisons, we're just going as far as Chesapeake Expressway, and that's a distance of 7 miles. The SEPG is tolled also from where it connects on I-264 to where it goes to the Chesapeake Expressway. That's an 18-mile trip, and then there's 4 additional miles along the Chesapeake Expressway to get to the intersection with I-64. This shows the relative difference in cost between the two trips. This is taking 264 and this, the SEPG, under the condition where both the SEPG and 264 are tolled. You can see it's roughly an 80 cent difference in generalized cost. When you toll all three roads, it's a 10 cents less of a difference, it's 77 cents. As I said before, the analysis metrics we used included all of those, but I'm only going to talk about the completed trips and congested travel speed. The other information that's grayed out is available in the final report, and then we'll talk about the HCM level of service and the SEPG hourly flows. If you look at this, this is the completed trips, and again, completed trips are the ones that start between 4 p.m. and end by 6 p.m. We model both before and after this evaluated period to get an accurate representation of flow. But you can see in 2012, the numbers that we would see for each of the three conditions, no incident, a low level of incidence, and high incidence. And as we go to 2034 in the base network, there's a significant increase in the number of trips, and that's because of the increased population. You also see that even with the SEPG and the no-told condition, there's very little difference between the no-build and the SEPG condition. And that's because the anticipated construction, especially along I-64 and at the 264-64 interchange, test as very successful. Also, there's been a change in the density areas of Virginia Beach. We're no longer building around Oceana the way we were before. As we apply tolls, though, note that, in fact, the total trips completed go down with the application of tolls so that it's slightly less than the no-build condition. So even with the SEPG, we have fewer trips completed if you apply the toll, and that's because vehicles are moving off of the tolled roads onto the city's arterials, clogging the city arterials. And if you toll the I-64 as well, you actually get a significant, an even more significant decrease. That's completed trips. The next slide shows the average travel times, and you can see how travel times would go up. And this, again, is for completed trips across the network. This is not just on the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt, but this is the average length of a trip throughout the city of Virginia Beach. And as we add tolls, the more vehicles move off of the tolled roads onto the city's arterials. A similar result is shown when we look at average speeds. All of the speeds, average speeds, are less than what we experience now. And that, again, is because we've added 1% centerline miles. Now, we've added more than 1% in capacity because we added lanes. But we've added 1% in centerline miles and a significant increase in the number of trips. That 25% increase drives it down. And as we apply tolls, you can see, again, people are moving off of the tolled roads onto city arterials. We anticipate that there would be a shift like that, but the amount of shift is greater than we would have thought. We've worked closely with the developers of the model at Caliper and with other tolling experts, and part of the reason for that is there's such a relatively small difference in the generalized cost of the trip options, whether you would use the SEPG and Chesapeake Expressway or stay on 264 and 64. Mr. Moss, did you have a question?
You know, Orlando has a great combination, as you probably know, of free interstates and Beeline Expressway, the Sun Parkway off the airport. I mean, they got a combination of. And I'm just curious if the behavior pattern that you see here is replicated in Orlando, because people do have alternatives, and do we see a similar driver choice of perceiving value of the tolls?
The perceived value of the toll is similar. I will say that one failing in this model is that it assumes rational behavior. And as you've seen throughout Hampton Roads, we do not typically exhibit rational behavior when it comes to tolls. So we assume that people would move to what it would be, in fact, the lower cost route. If people behave like they do with the tolls on the downtown and midtown tunnels, then that would change the results. But the big difference in Orlando is those roads tend to take people out of the city or into the city. And here, we take people out of our city into another city. So we're not really taking them into the toll or to the congestion-free area. And so because the cost of the two routes are so close to being the same, an accident on one that starts to build up congestion immediately causes everybody to take the alternate route. Now, that could be alleviated with a graduated toll scheme or tolling based on class of vehicle. Go ahead. Now we're going to look at some volumes and flow on the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt as we would predict them. This first estimate is along the section that parallels Oceana Boulevard, almost to where it connects at I-264. From the top to the bottom, it's showing you the no toll value, the SEPG and 264 toll value, and then the value with I-64 tolled as well. And that on the left column of numbers is the northbound and the right column of numbers is the southbound. And these are total flow values for the segment. This is not total values per lane, which you may be used to seeing. This is the total for a segment. Now this would be a we would expect a 60 to 65 mile per hour road, so you would expect to have somewhere between 2,000 and 2,200 vehicles per hour is the capacity of the road. So this is significantly less than the capacity of the SEPG. This next one shows you the same information, but for an area closer to General Booth. Again, we are only roughly half of the capacity of the roadway there. Go ahead. This next one is going to look down. This is down by Princess Anne and Indian River. A little bit higher volumes here, but still we're running only about 2,000 vehicles per hour per segment at the peak. And at Indian River, I should have mentioned this before, from Indian River up to 264, this is modeled as a four-lane road, and from essentially Indian River to the west to where it connects with the Chesapeake Expressway, it's modeled as a six-lane road. And the last place we show is right here near the Centerville Turnpike. We do get a little bit higher values in some of the estimates here. Now, these are all without accidents. We would expect that if there were an accident on I-64 or on I-264, that more vehicles would take the SEPG because they're going to dodge that congestion. But these comparison numbers are shown without accidents. Go ahead. Now, I said we would talk about level of service. These are just pictures to give you an idea of what the different levels of service mean. Level of service is a standard way of measuring the performance of a road. It's based off vehicle density per mile per lane. This is level of service A, B, and C. You can see A is virtually nobody on the road. Gradual increases you get to see. Level of service D is what planners typically seek. I think that's the standard within the city of Virginia Beach of what you want to see each of the roads at. At E, you're beginning to see some significant congestion. At the far right corner, it shows level of service F. That is highly congested, and that's what we would see, say, on Indian, you know, on I-260 or on I-64 near Indian River in the evening peak period, or on I-264 around Wichduck in the mornings as people are driving to work. That's level of service F, where cars are just inching along. Now, when we take the density levels that we have on the SEPG, go ahead to the next slide here. Go ahead, Pete, so it brings them up. We found that there were three areas that actually reached the level of service F. This one down here near the Chesapeake Expressway is actually caused by the Chesapeake Expressway. Some years ago, the SEPG and Oak Grove Connector projects were separated, so they're no longer the same. So we've modeled a six-lane road coming in, but Chesapeake plans only for four lanes on the Oak Grove Connector. So we're going from six lanes to four lanes. That causes a backup, and that spills back in and slows traffic. This one is the one that I mentioned earlier that's caused by backup coming by from Indian River and Elbow intersection. Now here, traffic does back up and blocks one of the lanes, but traffic is still able to go by on the other side. So the level of service goes down because there's traffic backed up onto the SEPG, but people that are not getting out there are still able to drive about 35 miles per hour through that section. And then the last one is right up at Oceana, General Booth area, Dam Neck, and that's, again, caused by vehicles exiting. There is still one lane free, but average traffic speeds there go down quite a lot. Go ahead. And we did want to provide you a comparison to what the average level of use on the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt is to roads that you may be familiar with. If you look at Shore Drive, this is from the Lessner Bridge to Great Neck. That's a distance of about 1.5 miles, and you would typically see, if you were able to stop time at 5 p.m. and count the cars, it's roughly 257. So you see a typical vehicle per mile, roughly per lane. Although it's not exactly a density because the number of lanes change in here. And you can see the same values for Great Neck and Dam Neck, Indian River Road. So what you see is that the SEPG is carrying about the same volume of traffic as that 5 mile stretch, 5 mile stretch of Dam Neck between General Booth and Princess Anne Road. Mr. Kirshner from the Virginia Beach Traffic Department also looked at interstate comparisons, and the volume that we would see on the SEPG is pretty equivalent to what you would see on I-264 near Burden in the PM period. As I mentioned, we did do some hurricane evacuation studies. This was to assess the value of the SEPG getting people out. We did not do a hurricane study, so this is not the same sort of evacuation study that you would that you would see if you looked at this in detail. We looked at two categories, a Category 2 that makes direct landfall on Virginia Beach, and a Category 3 that makes landfall in the Outer Banks and then moves up to the north and actually arrives as a tropical storm when it gets to Virginia Beach. That's the Isabel scenario. And we looked at the population clearance times for 50% of the people to be cleared, 75 and 90%. Go ahead. These three tables show you 50%, 75, and 90% condition. For the two hurricane scenarios, the upper one for each hurricane scenario is looking at the without an SEPG, and the value below that is with the SEPG. And then the columns are here with no low and high level of accidents. And what you see when you look at the table is that there is an improvement generally provided by the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt, but it's small, much smaller than we anticipated going in. Roughly you gain a half hour in clearance times. And the reason for that is the significant improvement to the 264-64 interchange and expanding the I-64 and the high-rise bridge. And if you think about it, most of the traffic that we face when people are leaving the area backs up from the high-rise bridge all the way up to 264, and that's what's slowing people down. So this was a bit of a surprise to us. We did apply the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt to a 2012 network to see what impact it would have now, and it's at least five times greater flow in today's conditions than what we would see in 2034. Go ahead, Pete. One of the things that we did find, though, was that the real problem for Virginia Beach in the future, assuming that these other roads are completed, is not going to be getting people out of the city, but getting people out of the region. And that's because there's a significant backup that begins near Bowers Hill. And this red line is showing where traffic is redlined, all the way back almost to the 264-64 interchange. So the real issue that needs to be corrected regionally is to fix that Bowers Hill section, which I think people already know, but which is right now not planned. Go ahead. So in summary, in our analysis, we show that the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt does provide a slight improvement in system performance. The anticipated volumes are lower than were provided in previous forecast. We believe that that's due to the reduced buildup in the southeastern portion of Virginia Beach, largely because of the restriction placed on the city due to Oceana, and also because the forecast long-range improvements to the transportation network appear to be very effective. The tolls, when applied, shift traffic to the arterials. That reduces the system performance. And finally, the Southeastern Parkway Greenbelt does provide some improvement in hurricane evacuation times, but they're slight. And with that, I'd be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Very informative. I've got one quick one. On the widening of the high-rise bridge, how many lanes were y'all using in your modeling?
It's three lanes in each direction there.
Thank you. Other questions?
Can you pull up the next chart, please? So each of you should probably be asking, so what? And then what's next? And so that's where I kind of step in here with the staff's review of this and involvement over the last 2 years. And I want to thank Mike and the team for an outstanding job. You have a world-class transportation model that we would be recommending to, and I've asked them to schedule briefings to the HR, to the PDC, or more importantly to the TPO, so that they can see the investment we've made, you've made, to include paying for modeling in a portion of Chesapeake, and that they should be coming on with their local dollars to continue to expand this at the local basis so that they can have the same kind of fidelity as they work through theirs. So the investment that the City of Virginia Beach made to create the SITS with ODU will serve great dividends to the other localities. Since the HR TAC at their last meeting made a decision to move forward to the public hearing stage of their program and have moved forward with recommendations to advance the regional transportation projects without tolling, we've kind of looked at this in a more focused manner. Clearly, if you were to construct the Southeastern Parkway, it would create capacity for development in our ITA area, development along our Princess Anne corridor, connectivity to that which could come off of the Bird Neck connection with 264, but it is a significant amount, a reduction in the significant amount of development potential than what we originally were thinking in the 80s, coming off those boom years that your city, our city had, and having a glide path of expansion that said, well, gosh, if we're going to build like this, we're just going to keep on growing. And that's what the Southeastern Parkway originally was addressing, was that growth that we have subsequently entered into agreements on the land use around Oceana, in the ITA between Fentress and Oceana. And you combine that with the huge investment the City Council and the people of Virginia Beach have made on the road network that we currently enjoy. The opening of PA4, the connection of Nemo 5, the potential of Centerville 1 and 2, and the connection that Lynn Haven 11 is providing you. The focusing of Princess Anne 7 and the connectivity that we're doing there. We continue to invest our dollars to deal with the real-world transportation needs that you have before you and those that you can see on your horizon and that you want to deal with. Clearly, the creation of the Southeastern Parkway would have a significant reduction to those arterial connections we have within the city. When Mike speaks of the system, he's talking of the whole system. Our arterial roads in our city, the 264, the 64, the Southeastern Parkway, all the roads that we travel on every day. It's all part of a system. So if you opened up that connectivity that Southeastern Parkway would give you, it would reduce further the congestion, and it's a natural occurrence, that we currently have on our roads. It would certainly improve speeds and numbers of trips, without a doubt. However, it would require not only the construction of the Southeastern Parkway, but the intersection, first the connection at Oak Grove, because you heard Mike say we're going three lanes to two lanes, and that would be an issue that would be backing up, and he showed you that one graph of level F service that it would create. It would also require us to deal with the Dominion Boulevard Oak Grove connection, because Chesapeake is not spending those dollars as part of their project to expand that intersection to take Southeastern Parkway onto that. You heard Mike use 2,200 vehicles per lane capacity associated with what the Southeastern Parkway would give you. What he showed you in the modeling is that we would only be using it at about 1,000 vehicles per lane. So that gives you a relative order of magnitude of whether or not investing in this project would be carrying the volume that the construction would provide you, that the capacity of the road network would provide you. And when you combine that with estimates of construction costs well exceeding $1 billion to build this road and deal with the mitigation, the wetland impacts, environmental impact mitigation that could be into the hundreds of millions of dollars because your construction costs in order to avoid it would have to go to bridging instead of filling, not unlike the nice bridge we did over West Neck Creek here on Nemo, then you would find that the return on investment for vehicle congestion relief and transportation efficiency would be a tough pill to swallow. Let's get on the next chart, please. So what should be our next steps? What would you expect our staff to be doing and everything? Well, we have to look at, should we continue to model and expand the model? Should we look at the high-rise bridge expansion? Should we look at what would Bowers Hill improvements be if we could figure out what the optimal solution is and then translate? I don't think the HR TAC has those dollars to do. They're pretty booked out. You've pretty much laid out a program for all the billions that our tax dollars will do. And so there's only a certain amount of additional modeling that we could do. We think that the modeling that has to continue is probably transferred to the adjoining cities as they want to get involved in the business of understanding a true regional transportation network. We need to finalize the report. I want to thank Tom Leahy and Robert Guy working with the team. This is really their first major report coming out of a significant basis, and they really invested in those PEs and that coder and that PhD so that they would have the modeling simulation. Now, hopefully, if they get the other cities to buy in, they'll probably go buy hire a report writer so that they can, because they got to produce the outputs, because this report wore everybody out. They love the jazz of modeling and simulation, but sometimes you got to turn it into the output that the client wants to have. And Tom Leahy and the Public Works Department work really diligently with you all to craft something that would make some sense to everybody as you got into this and do it. We need to take a look at our current investment, you know. I think our recommendation for the future of the Southeastern Parkway is lackluster at best at this point, looking at the numbers versus the cost. And it's unfortunate to say that, but so much has changed since we originally put the Southeast Parkway into our mindsets in the late 70s and 80s. It's been there. Some of the senior members of council would tell you they can remember those conversations and why this came to pass. We have currently acquired 1,394 acres of right-of-way, 1,394 acres. And so we need to be able to provide you an assessment of where they are, what they are, and how they relate to that fourth bullet up there, and whether or not the work that we've done still should not be just discounted and put back on the market, because there are still some opportunities to construct, maybe not parallel to Oceana Boulevard, because that's functioning just fine and it's just parallel to it. But there are segments south of that may provide some opportunities for us to include into our master streets and highway planning as we go forward. And so we have an obligation to you to come back and say, look, we think we ought to preserve these investments today, and that we should market these and put these back out there for other private investment opportunities. And so we have that staff work to do for you over the next couple months to come back to you.
Well, we appreciate great work on everybody's part, and a lot of good information, and still a lot to be done. Yes, sir.
Just because we have a CIP, I don't know how hard it could be just to get a real macro level assessment at the top level, not the details. But if we built out our whole backlog of roads in our CIP, which was about $500 billion, and all that was done, how does, obviously, it should further diminish probably the value of suspecting the South. But understanding that would be important, I think. So someone said it's $1.8 billion, which was the last number I saw, for the Southeast Expressway. And then someone said, for $500 million, you can build out everything we have between our close to complete and unfunded roads. What does that mean? Because then people have a same time frame, you know, one quarter of the cost, a lot more filling.
Councilman Moss, you're absolutely right. I want to thank the council for allowing us to, and we partnered with the Federal Highway Administration and VDOT to acquire cost share dollars to fund the original transportation model system that we had. But you all invested heavily in trying to determine the analytics associated with whether or not this was a logical or a affordable solution for our transportation system. And I think that investment, those dollars spent, though we may not get outcomes of actually construction here, you at least have the fidelity necessary to know why you're making a decision to not move forward with this parkway, and to do, as John has said, take those dollars and take a look at what that investment. I would agree with you, Councilman Moss, that we could model that. They will give us a cost estimate to keep on modeling, but I don't think it
I think we would better be served to hear Phil Pullen's briefing after stormwater today and take a look at that, because I know you guys are all engaged and want to hear the roads network briefing today. But it's all a data point in your decision-making process. And I just want to conclude by once again thanking our partners at the ODU SITS and say what a wonderful job you all have done.
Other questions or comments? I think I would say this, and everyone at this table in planning is a whole lot smarter than I am. I really think we really need to look at this carefully, you know, what we've got here, because there are going to be opportunities, whether it be planning roads that would tie in to the land around it and help ease traffic congestion, or the use of that land if we put it back on the tax rolls. And I think this is something that we should take our time on to truly understand and make sure we do it right, and that the way we've learned in the past to make sure we do things right. We've done a pretty good job. Barbara?
But I think following up now with this update of the ITA, because I think it's those changes in the ITA really caused all this to make the changes. Because if
she's a planner, I'm not. You know what I mean?
If it had stayed at that 3 units per acre that it had originally been planned, then you know we would have had the growth, and it would have all been very different. But you know, now that we do have different opportunities, and when we see that these proposed ITA roads that we're going to see in a little bit, you know, the difference that they're going to make. And the uses, the land uses.
There you go. All right, a lot of opportunity out there is what I'd say.
Yeah, great.
Okay.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you all very much. Great presentations.
Good job.
Okay, next.
It's back. Today I have Doug Smith and Brian Solis will be presenting. I think Brian's a lead briefer today. Another perspective on where we have an opportunity to locate the Hillier Ignite Fitness Park. And I want to just let you know that there's been a huge investment on staff and the sponsors. Luke, appreciate you being here today. Efforts to work with the oceanfront and the community to try and find the optimal location to provide this amenity to the beach. So, Brian, if you would, please.
Brian, we're glad to have you.
I cannot think of a more different brief than the one you just received. Pleasure to be back. I'd like to make some introductions, if I could, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Mr. Luke Hillier is here, representing Ignite Foundation, the founder of that. Billy Allman, who is the present CEO of WPL and contributed his services towards this project. Doug Mars, who's their creative director. And Ben Dickerson, who's their athletic director with the Hillier Ignite Foundation. We also have Emily Rothrock, who also is a landscape designer who helped pull together the plans that both the original plans and the revised plans. And I see Mr. Billy Harrison over there as well as support. The executive lead on this project has continued to be Deputy City Manager Doug Smith. And of course, the man that's kind of been doing all the relationship building and perhaps knows the resort as better as anyone is Mike Eason. He's certainly been shepherding this project.
Well, we're glad to have everyone here.
So as opposed to what you received in your packets, we've got even less slides here and gotten even more brief, if that's a term, to really focus on the fact that just taking you where we are today versus rehashing where we have been, it's a great story to tell. And Emily, the clicker's gone, so if you wouldn't mind advancing for me, I'd really appreciate it. As a reminder, from where we were in December and January timeframe, Mr. Hillier was inspired by a beach fitness park and equipment from Hotel Luz in the Santa Monica area of California. This is kind of a overview or an aerial of the footprint at Santa Monica that is much less than we're proposing to do here in Virginia Beach, but perhaps if it's successful, something we can build upon in the future. And I believe Mr. Hillier in a previous briefing, as well as Mr. Eason, have kind of told you and communicated the positive experiences that Santa Monica, California has had with that park. So where were we from January? As you can see, we kind of mapped out all of the improvements that are within the resort area, starting with Grauman Island Park to the extreme south at 1st and 2nd Street. We've also programmed in the yellows, the light yellow and the dark yellow are those special events and athletics that are programmed throughout the beach itself that kind of helped us determine, among other factors, why the northern end of the resort is more appropriate for this activity than perhaps others. If you look at the pink dots, those are stages that are set up for events like the American Music Festival and other musical events, special events that draw a lot of visitors and residents to the resort. You have the 10th Street Playground, you have the 17th Street Park, 15th Street Pier, 24th Street Park, the Naval Aviation Memorial or Monument Park. You have Neptune's Park at 31st Street. You have the 32nd Street Playground. And then a stage that is put up at 34th Street. And so if you look at that map, and the presentation is in front of you, that I put, you can see why the original location was chosen. It's the only one, and that's right here on 40th Street, that does not have any programmed events on the beach itself or any permanent or temporary improvements on it. So that is one of the reasons why the 40th Street area was chosen to begin with. That chart down the bottom, can't really read it there, but that's kind of a list of events that occur, everything from North American Sand Soccer to ECSC to the Patriotic Festival and so on, and surf camps that occur in those yellow areas. So with the feedback that we received during that public hearing on the original location at 40th Street, that's why we went and did this inventory and tried to find an alternative location. And what we determined is with an amenable owner, Russell Lyons, and he's definitely been a help and a relationship building there. We've determined that 31st Street is the right location. We might need to make some adjustments with outdoor beach volleyball, but we believe we can make that happen. So if we can, Emily.
Hey, Brian, just to be clear, I think you mean 36th.
36th Street, I beg your pardon. 36th Street, thank you. So between the 31st, 35th Street Sheraton and 36th Street Belvedere is right where the park would go. So where we've been since January, we've listened and learned from those comments that were made during that public hearing process. We established that new location based on a lot of that criteria that I communicated just now. I worked one-on-one with adjacent property owners, the Willises, that are going to reopen the Belvedere and the cafe for at least one more season. We've made some adjustments, and we believe that they're happy with that current layout. Reached out to adjacent property owners. We've continued to coordinate with our friends in Public Works and Parks and Recreation to make sure they can continue to maintain the beach and maintain the equipment in a routine way throughout its life. Ensured we have our ADA compliant as possible for what it is, and we're going to continue to coordinate with beach event programming. I'd also be remiss if I didn't mention that our friends in Parks and Recreation have really been helpful in helping us with the ADA compliance piece and lending their expertise in terms of maintenance of the equipment. Design consultants have reached out to National Playground consultants to make sure that we had a good gauge of what the potential usage is for the park, and all of those things were considered in this new layout. If you could, Emily, that's proposed. And so what you have here is the Sheraton at 35th Street, Belvedere at 36th Street, and the connector park here. These dashed lines are not improvements, but they're actually a wide path outside of the fall zones, if you will, the equipment. So all these lines you see here are the equipment. That folks coming down these stairs would have an open path to get to the beachfront itself. You have an ADA compliant decking that would have landings here and here in between the fitness equipment layout to observe or participate to the extent possible. And we have an ADA compliant portable restroom there as well. So wrapping up, what we are really just trying to achieve is make sure that Virginia Beach and doing everything we can to continue to be at the top of the list, or at least the top 10 or 15 of the fittest cities in the world is what we're trying to achieve. And we believe that this improvement will help us get there. So with that, I'll stand by for any questions or any comments from the team.
Rosemary.
First of all, I'd like to thank Luke for hanging in there and coming back with a new location. I think this will be great for the beach. I'm the only person here that actually lives on the boardwalk, and I see what happens down there every day. And it's really fun. I have people playing volleyball in front of my condo, not year-round, but quite frequently. Then there's all kinds of activities going on, and that's part of what makes it a fun place to live, is to being able to observe and... I'm not saying get engaged with all these different things, but I get to watch them, and it's fun. It's really, really fun. And I know my own children were really excited when they heard about this. They said, is this going to really happen? Because when they come to visit, they want to go down and work out. So I'm so glad that y'all were able to come up with another site. It's going to be a great amenity, and I look forward to voting for it next week.
Amelia.
Well, I'm looking at this page. If you go back to that page.
The site plan.
Site plan. It is a great improvement. You don't have someone right, you know, in the view of their homes or anything. I like that. Even if you do not want to participate, you can still be able to see, given that opportunity for the ADA compliance. And I'm ready to
Yeah, all the credit goes to Billy and Emily and Mr. Hillier's team and working with Russell Lyons. And I really have to give credit to Mr. Lyons in terms of brokering that dialogue with the Willises
really
and the Belvedere to come up with an amenable layout and location.
Bobby?
Yeah, I just want to applaud you for your outreach, and really, I think, crafting what could be a very win-win situation. And, I think I'm very favorably predisposed to this right now. Thank you.
Shannon.
Well, I kind of feel like I need to say something here in regards to my last performance during the Hillier and Knight vote, or lack thereof in my case. But
abstinence.
It was a tough decision for me last time and the decision to make no decision, because I really do think the project is great. And I do love seeing it here, and I felt maybe we didn't do our due diligence as a city last time, and I wasn't as informed as I should have been, I felt. Not for lack of trying, I just didn't have all the information that I should have. But at any rate, this is a much better location in my opinion, and I'm very happy the way this has turned out. I'm sorry that you've had to jump through a few more rings to make that happen, but I'm very happy with this location, and I thank you for being open-minded and looking at other locations and finding something that is a little more positive going forward. So thank you.
And speaking of going forward, Mr. Mayor, if all the comments are positive, we are planning on putting on your agenda next week for a vote.
Very good.
Any
other questions or comments? I would sit back and say to you, I think after our last round, there was disappointment, win or lose. And I think we learned from this. I applaud the effort that's taken place here. More than anything, I thank you for reaching out to the property owners, getting them on board, and we also thank the applicant for sticking with us. And Ben, give me 50 sit-ups, buddy. That guy at the end, he'll work you down. He is a tough cookie. All right, let's move on. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, next thing, capital improvement program, stormwater, Phil Davenport.
Yes, sir. I found the clicker.
I think we're pretty good on this, President. What you have in there, I think, is pretty good.
He used to train at Wearing Stone. And you never see such a guy.
What everybody has at their table should be accurate.
Strong as he could be. Okay, Dave, we got an hour.
Yes, sir. We're actually doing very well.
I had no doubt. I'm just reminding him.
He's only going to give me 4 or 5 minutes now.
These are good presentations.
This is actually kind of a cool gimmick.
cover? That southeastern parkway not being built could be a lot of...
There we go. Okay, so we're going to talk today about the Stormwater Utility Fund and give you a little update on that with a main focus on the Capital Improvement Program. So the areas we'll talk about, fund summary, functional components, and we'll have some closing and whatever discussion you prefer to have. So looking first at the revenues. The revenues for the stormwater utility primarily come from the fee, and that's about $39.4 million. And that's based on an ERU, equivalent residential unit fee, of 0.333 per day, which is an annual fee of $158.48. We have about 248,723 ERUs in the city. Of that, about half are your residential customers. The other half are the non-residential. And again, that generates about $39 million. We have a little bit more revenue, $440,000, that comes from various other sources. The way that breaks out for FY17 is actually about $63.6 million of program work. Now, you're going to say, well, why do you have so much program work if you only have $39 million? And the way we look at that is, in addition to the pay-as-you-go money, we have some bonds. We have $44 million worth of bonds that we have already sold and are working off of. We have an additional authorized bond amount of $37.4 million. Those will be sold when the cash is needed to sell them. So, our functional components are basically water quality, flood control, operations, and maintenance. All of those are very well integrated. We have a lot of things out in our system. We have ditches, pipes, pump stations, lakes, outfalls, lots of features, and we have to maintain those. Ditches get clogged, pipes get clogged, cave-ins occur in pipes. We have pump stations that motors need to be replaced. Things, stuff happens with them. So we've got all kinds of things we need to do. And the operations and maintenance basically takes care of all of that and makes sure the system operates the way it's designed to work. If we have it working fully the way it's supposed to be, by design, and we still have flooding issues, then we move into flood control projects, which become big standalone capital improvement programs. And then water quality. We're going to touch on water quality just a little bit today because we've got a full presentation that will be done sometime over the next couple of months to talk about all of the different water quality requirements that are coming about with our new permits and the new VPDES requirements that come with that and some of the costs that go with it. So this presentation, we're just focused on what's in the CIP right now. Overall, this is what the stormwater program looks like. Too small to read, but we're going to show you some bigger blow-ups of each of those individual sections. And each of those will be done by some of our managers in the stormwater utility, and I will introduce those to you now. Operations and maintenance, Cheryl Cole will be doing the discussion about operations and maintenance, Melanie Coffey, water quality, and Mike Mundy, our standalone flood control projects. So with that, Cheryl.
Cheryl, glad to have you.
Well, here we have this mature and aging drainage system in our city, and one of the things that we've come to realize is anytime we get a drainage complaint, the first thing we need to look at is maintenance of the system. Only after we've gone through and made sure that everything's been maintained, that it's in proper repair, that's the only time we should go forward and look at engineering or construction fixes. This is cost-effective and it's sensible, but it really emphasizes the importance of operations and maintenance in this process. Maintaining the system is a large and ongoing challenge. Our system continues to grow and age with every year that passes and every project that we build. There are many components that make up the system, and we've given you some numbers on some of them here so that you can see a little bit about the magnitude of the challenge that we face in maintaining this. CIP funds are one of the tools that we use to maintain the system. This is the overall CIP program that will be requested for operations and maintenance for FY17. You can see we manage 9 CIP projects at a value of $15 million in the request. You'll recall we have an inventory of over 1,200 miles of pipe. 7416 supplements the work of our 5 in-house repair crews in maintaining the pipe system. This is used for 4 different categories each year. The first category is the miscellaneous drainage projects. We spend $1 to $2 million on these per year. The slide shows you the ones that we're going to be doing for 16 and 17. The second category is our major neighborhood rehabs. Those costs vary depending on the condition and the size of the neighborhood, and we'll look at some of those on the next slide. The corrugated metal pipes, this is going to be a new program for 17. We have a lot of metal pipes at random places in the city, and with the salt that we have in our soils, you can imagine that they're just not holding up, so we're trying to develop a program to address those. And of course, every year we do $1 million worth of contracted cave-in repairs with the CIP. As I mentioned in 7416, the second category was the major neighborhood projects. Rehabs. These neighborhoods are identified based on the number of cave-ins that we find in them, and then we further prioritize them. We go in, we clean the entire system, we do major inspections, we actually CCTV inside the pipes, we inspect all the structures, and then ultimately we repair all of the deficiencies that we find within the neighborhood. This slide shows you the 7 neighborhoods that we've worked with thus far under this program. Since FY13, we've spent $18 million on this process. This shows the next 12 neighborhoods that we expect to be addressing, the current schedules, and the projected cost of $19 million. It's important to note that this is an ongoing program that should be kept in what we do. Our infrastructure is aging. Unless we go in and address these neighborhoods like this, we're really throwing away the investment that we've put into the system at this point. One other CIP that's used for pipe-related work is a smaller one. It's our residential cost participation program. We had found in the past that we had citizens that would come to us and ask us to pipe the roadside ditches in their front yards. We really didn't have a drainage reason to do that, but aesthetically, they didn't like having ditches in their yards. So our compromise was to develop this cost participation program where the city paid a portion and the citizen paid a portion. And this CIP is used for that, the city portion of that. In the last few years, our participation in that has dropped, but we found we're getting a lot of calls from citizens to help them address vegetation in the lakes. A lot of the homeowner groups, they just don't know how to handle it. And we're proposing in FY17 to expand our scope in the CIP to allow us to do cost participation on those projects. We have approximately 160 miles of off-road ditch to maintain, and 7023 helps us manage that. You'll recall that in FY14, we began a ditch maintenance program, an overall program we developed. We broke the city into 16 zones, and every year we do one zone in the north and one zone in the south. Our ultimate goal is to achieve an 8 to 10 year maintenance cycle on the ditches, and to do that, we've been using both CIP and in-house resources. Currently, we have in-house crews working in Zone C in the northwestern part of the city, and they're soon going to be mobilizing down into Zone N in the south. Contract crews are up working in Zone B in the north central portion of the city. This CI, as I said, 7023 helps us manage the overall off-road ditch program. Every year we have to develop plans for every ditch that we're going to clean. We have to carry those then to the regulatory agencies and get permits to be able to do the cleaning. So this CIP helps us with that. And it also pays for some of the contracted ditch work that we do, supplementing our 3 in-house crews. The effects of this program can be seen in our cycle times. When we first started this program, we had a 16-year ditch cleaning cycle to get through the whole city, and I can tell you we weren't getting through all of them. We've now reduced that to a 12-year, and once we've done this cycle one time, we'll achieve our 8- to 10-year goal that we had looked for. These are the two CIPs that we use to maintain our 15 stormwater pump stations and their related structures. The day-to-day routine maintenance is done by two in-house pump station mechanics, but all of the major projects are done under the CIP. 7411 provides the funding for the Oceanfront Hurricane Protection Project. A lot of people call that the boardwalk, but as you all know, it's actually a massive stormwater structure with pump stations and large pipes that run underneath the boardwalk. Every year in the spring, the Army Corps of Engineers comes out and does an inspection of this project, so we use the CIP to keep this project in good shape so that we pass those inspections. 7412 is the second CIP that we use for our 15 stations. Two of the major projects that we're working on this year and next are our SCADA implementation. That's going to allow us to monitor the stations remotely. Right now, we have to actually send someone out to the stations during the height of a storm to figure out if the pumps are working. This is going to let us put somebody sat down at a computer where they'll be able to see exactly what's going on with every pump, and that's a good thing. Our second major project is the repair and rehabilitation of the 16th Street pump station. Public Works is responsible for maintaining 492 lakes, and as you all know, the greatest cost in that is dredging these lakes. Of the $5.2 million that we'll be requesting for this CIP, a full $4.7 will go towards the dredging program. In the past, we had done condition assessments on all the lakes, and we had pulled out the worst 50 and then further prioritized them to create what we call the top 50 lakes dredging list. Public Works has then developed annual services contracts with a dredging contractor and a design firm so that they can move these projects much more quickly. Since FY13, this program completed the dredging of 9 lakes. We currently have 2 under construction and 3 under design. Before this CIP was added, it was estimated the lakes were on a 950-year dredging cycle. But since this CIP was added, we're now at a 95-year, which is not wonderful, but it's a big improvement. This shows you the top lakes on the list, the 9 that we have completed, the 2 we have under construction in Brigadoon, and the 3 we have under design. 2 of them are in Green Run, and 1 is in Brigadoon. This gives you number 16 through 32 that carries us out to FY21. And number 33 through 50 carrying us out to FY26. Also accomplished under this same lake maintenance CIP is the maintenance of our 58 dams and spillways that are in the lakes. Kingston Dam was rehabilitated in FY15 to bring the dam into compliance with the state dam regulations. As you know, the citizens were not happy with the final water elevations in that lake. So right now we have a study underway to see if we can raise that water elevation and by how much we'll be able to do that. And that study is due to us in the spring, so we'll be coming back with more information on that. We also repaired the outfall structure and pipe system at the Lake Doughty Dam this year. For the future, we started a project to establish which of our 58 dams and spillways are regulated by the state. That's going to give us a much better information to program the repairs that we have to do on these in the future. With the expansion of the stormwater program and operations over the past few years, we've begun to experience some very crowded work conditions, and we propose to address that with the addition of a modular building. The new modular building would be located at the Dam Neck Road facility. It would seat 19 people, and it would provide some conference room space for their collaborative activities. $490,000 was previously funded in FY16 for this project. Virginia Beach successfully competed for FEMA grant funding for elevating privately owned properties that were experiencing repeated flood damage. In 2010, the first grant was received to elevate 8 homes. our current status on that, one of the 8 original homeowners dropped out of the process. The other 7 homes are essentially complete, and Public Works and Fire continue to work on some remaining issues on 4 of the properties. No further funds will be requested for the CIP in FY17. The second grant was awarded in September of 14. This is going to elevate 8 homes, 5 on Bay Island and 3 in Lynn Haven Colony. These projects are currently under design. We expect them to go to bid this spring, and construction would be complete in fall of 18. Looking ahead, the city has been notified that we're receiving grant number 3 for $875,000 to elevate an additional 5 homes. And grant number 4 application period is currently underway. It's due in June of 16, and this will apply. The city's applying to elevate 5 more homes under that. At this time, I'd like to turn the presentation over to Melanie Coffey, who's going to brief you on 2 very important aspects of our program, water quality and regulatory compliance.
Thank you, Cheryl and Melanie. We welcome you.
Thank you. Thank you, Cheryl. Good evening. I'm the new manager of the Surface Water Regulatory Compliance Division. Public Works has actually created a separate little group now to basically manage this changing water quality world that we're in now. Our program really, it's focused on managing these requirements for water quality improvements in our waterways. And I think y'all have heard before, there's 3 primary waterways in Virginia Beach: the Chesapeake Bay, the Southern Rivers, and the Atlantic Ocean. And they each have their unique characteristics and water quality concerns. So our programs are focused on improving water quality and compliance with the local, state, and federal regulations. The requested FY17 water quality program is just over $3 million, which is about 14% of the utility fund, as Phil mentioned earlier. There are 6 projects that are focused on permit compliance and water quality improvements, and I'm going to go through each of those with y'all. The Surface Water Regulatory Compliance Program, this is a new water quality CIP requested this year, and the focus on this one is going to be on compliance with the city's new MS4 permit. The draft permit is actually going to be out for public notice tomorrow by DEQ. And they're anticipating a permit issuance date of May 1st or June 1st, depending on that public comment process. We do have, as Phil mentioned, a comprehensive briefing, you know, scheduled for you in the next couple months, so we'll go into more details on that. But basically, the MS4 permit really is just requiring us to know and to track every possible source of surface water pollution in the city and to manage it. So that's kind of our all-encompassing goal of this permit. So our first year of effort is really going to be a time of collaboration between the various departments and the divisions that are going to be supporting the permit. Now, I've highlighted some of the 5 main elements of the permit program, which is basically going to be our operating manual. So these elements are the program administration and reporting, which includes our reporting and tracking, our management of our high-priority city facilities, and our staff training program. The stormwater pollution reduction portion is basically Chesapeake Bay TMDL, the pollution diet, and also our local TMDLs. The operational requirements include our inspections and our water quality monitoring programs. The infrastructure data management is going to cover our asset data with extra focus on stormwater management facilities and the areas that are treated by those. And it's also including our public outreach and education. Okay, the water quality restoration participation project, this is just a new phase of the previous CIP 7159. It's been used to take advantage of cost participation projects that are focused on water quality improvements. And the primary project that's underway in this is the Lynn Haven River Basin Ecosystem Restoration Project. It's a joint venture with the Corps of Engineers. And right now the design and lease acquisition are underway for phase 1 of the project, and that's going to be for the creation of reef habitat and submerged aquatic vegetation. The city share of this phase is estimated at about $1.5 million. Stormwater quality enhancements, too, provides funding for basically the planning, design, and construction of stormwater management facilities and retrofit projects citywide. And the permit requires that we identify our projects that we plan to construct that are going to meet our Chesapeake Bay TMDL requirements and our other local TMDLs. So these projects are going to be identified as part of our planning process over the next 2 years. We've completed several retrofit projects. I've listed them up here. I wasn't going to go into details on all of them, but basically the total cost of these is about $1.7 million. We also have a couple of projects that are under construction. The Mill Dam Creek Stream Restoration Project is in the final landscaping phase, and that project will be used towards compliance with our Chesapeake Bay TMDL requirements. And we also have the Owls Creek Boat Pump Out Facility, which is under construction, and that will be wrapping up in April. This is going to be a similar facility to the one that's in place at the Lynnhaven Marina, and it's going to support our desire to have a no-discharge zone within Owls Creek. We also have several CIP projects that are focused on high-priority watersheds in the city. So this one, the Lynnhaven River, is part of the Chesapeake Bay watershed. And we've completed preliminary design for a large retrofit project at the Pembroke Lakes off of Independence Boulevard. The total project cost is estimated at just under $5 million. And what we'd be doing is basically upgrading the lake to improve the pollutant removal capability of it, and this would give us credits towards Chesapeake Bay TMDL compliance. Basically, it consists of adding like four bays to the lakes to improve settling of sediment and also creating wetlands and aeration.
Question on that one, if I could.
Yes, sir.
That lake, because I know people, my mother-in-law lives on that lake, the city easements down through the center, but the property rights belong to the people who own it. I'd just be interested later to understand how that's all working. I'll get questions from the neighbors because they know me, just how that's all working and how we're outreaching, since that's not a city only, they own the private property, how that's working.
Yes, sir. The Elizabeth River is also part of the Chesapeake Bay watershed, and we've completed preliminary design of three lake retrofit projects similar to the one that I just mentioned. These total about $4.7 million, and all three of these projects are similar and would also be used towards compliance with the Chesapeake Bay TMDL requirements. Also, just as a side note, we submitted for Stormwater Local Assistance Fund grants from DEQ this past December. And we just received information last week from DEQ that the Kemp's Lake project was selected for a $1.275 million award of grant funding. Thank you. Yay. We're very excited about it. There were 77 projects submitted, and only 17 were awarded grant funding, and ours was one of the largest four that got awards. Thanks. And finally, the Southern River watershed. This one includes both the Back Bay, the North Landing River, and the Northwest River secondary watersheds. And there are permit requirements to implement projects also here and programs to address the local TMDL requirements, even though it's not Chesapeake Bay. So this CIP is specifically focused on doing those projects. And I'd like to turn it over now to Mike Mundy to talk about the flood control portion.
So we've talked about water quality and operations and maintenance. Let's talk about flood control. We confirm areas working through maintenance and inspection. If still seeing a drainage problem, we study the existing system and investigate. We evaluate existing pipe capacities. We look at adding additional pipes and inlets. We consider if a storm drain retention pond would be helpful. We consider incorporating water quality within all of our drainage improvement projects. And we study if pump stations are necessary. So let's take a look at what we did last year, or some of what we did last year. For neighborhood drainage improvement projects, excuse me, we did Lawson Forest and also Thurgood. For roadway culvert improvements, we worked in the southern end of the city, working on Heads River, Craig's Causeway, and Muddy Creek Road. Now let's take a look at projects we have ongoing right now. South Lake Holly is a neighborhood drainage improvement project. That slide is of High Point Road. Indian Creek Road is another culvert improvement project in the southern end of the city. And then Cape Henry Tidegate is in Lynnhaven Colony and Cape Story by the Sea. And this is one of our new style projects. We're incorporating three sluice gates to help fight against tide. And it will protect up to an elevation of about five. Now let's take a look at our flood control program. The requested flood control program for FY17 budget is $5.75 million and will be used to support the following 13 CIP projects. And I'll go ahead and start talking about each of the individual projects. Aragona Drainage Improvement Project will address neighborhood drainage inadequacies in the Aragona subdivision. Public Works Operation cleaned, inspected, and made minor repairs to the subdivision existing storm drain system in 2012 and 2013. Evaluation of the existing system identified improvements for Sullivan Boulevard and Whistler Lane, which are scheduled for construction in the second half of 2017 and early 2018. And the project's currently under design. Baker Road Culvert and Ditch Improvement Project is being coordinated with the SGA office and development improvements for Burton Station. The project is currently in the acquisition phase and construction is scheduled to occur in 2017 and again in a little bit of 2018. Bellamy Manor Outfall Ditch will provide improvements to the existing primary combined pipe and ditch drainage system located within the neighborhood. The project includes bank stabilization of the outfall ditch located west of Orkney Drive and outfalling into Indian Lake 2. The main ditch located in south of Lock Lane, extending from Manor Drive to Hemlock Crescent, as well as west of Churchill Court. The project is scheduled to begin construction in October of this year. Central Resort District Drainage Improvements. It's a new requested CIP project for the FY17 program. It will provide for the study, design, and construction of storm drain improvements to address drainage inadequacies in the Northwest Dome subwatershed, the Southeast Dome subwatershed, the Virginia Beach Convention Center subwatershed, and the Second Precinct subwatershed. The project area is approximately 304 acres and extends from Atlantic Avenue along the east, the Convention Center to the west, 23rd Street to the north, and 17th Street to the south. The improvements will include, but are not limited to, stormwater collection system improvements, stormwater pump station, ocean outfall systems, and tidal backflow prevention devices. This improvement project will be evaluated and developed in multiple phases, coordinating with future development of the Central Resort District. Early estimates show this project exceeding $100 million in total cost. The initial area of concern is the intersection of 21st Street and Baltic Avenue and the surrounding approximately 15 acres. This area will be the first phase of the project, consisting of directing the reference 15 acres to the existing 16th Street pump station. Initial funding in FY17 will provide seed funding to determine the proposed alignment for the drainage improvements and initiate a design contract for this first phase. Citywide sea level rise and recurrent flooding analysis will conduct a comprehensive sea level rise recurrent flooding analysis of the four major watersheds located in the city. These four watersheds consist of the Elizabeth River, Lynn Haven River, Southern Watershed, and the Owls Creek / Atlantic Ocean Watershed. The goals in the analysis for each watershed are to identify the probable extent of sea level rise and recurrent flooding, evaluate appropriate adaptation strategies in the vulnerable areas, and identify budgetary costs for engineer protection measures and other adaptation programs. A comprehensive sea level rise recurrent flooding response plan will be prepared for each major watershed. The project is in the first year of this approximate three-year project. Lynn Haven River is the first watershed being analyzed, and currently we are identifying the probable extent of potential sea level rise and recurrent flooding impacts. College Park and Level Green Drainage Improvement Project will address drainage inadequacies in these two subdivisions. The project will evaluate the existing storm drain system and develop recommended drainage improvements, including outfall improvements and storm drain pipe system upgrades. The project currently is in the primary design phase, and construction improvements are scheduled to begin in 2018. Eastern Shore Drive Drainage Improvements, formerly known as Cape Henry Drainage Improvements, is similar to the oceanfront. The area was originally developed without an adequate drainage system, and modern infill has overwhelmed the limited system that does exist. The entire stretch of Shore Drive is subject to repetitive street flooding, and there have been numerous instances of structural flooding. The proposed project consists of three pump stations and replacement of an existing pump station that will all discharge into Long Creek. The anticipated total CIP project cost exceeds $70 million. Funding has been approved for the design and acquisition for Phase 1 and 2. The project also includes an interim project, Cape Henry Tide Gate, which will begin construction later this month and is scheduled to be completed in December 2016. The project consists of three automated sluice gates being installed in the Cape Henry ditch to hold back tide flooding up to elevation 5 feet.
Yeah, 1 second, please, Jim.
Mike, I thought this was, going back to the citywide analysis of flooding and sea level rise, I thought this was going to be done after that study was done, because I thought that this was not, this particular thing was not going to really generate as much relief as we thought it was going to, certainly not $18.9 million worth or the $70 million worth. So tell me a little bit about the schedule on this versus the other one.
Certainly. We wanted to keep the design moving forward, and so the design should be completed about the same time that the sea level rise and the stormwater modeling we have are completed, and we can then take an assessment whether what we still want to move forward makes sense or whether other ideas are possible. But we didn't want to lose the time, so what we wanted to do was take advantage of overlapping and doing both at the same time.
So the citywide study will be done when?
The citywide study will be done in 3 years, so about 2 years from now.
Okay, because I think, and Mr. Mayor, one of the things we've done when we were looking at this earlier, and it's been, I guess, Dave, it's been well over a year where you provided an analysis showing these different levels of relief and the cost, and showing the, frankly, what was being saved, and we were kind of upside down in it.
I remember.
We were spending $18 million to save $2 million worth of property.
Right.
So I think that concerns me, that if we're just doing design, that's fine. I mean, I don't want us just to do something that's not going to achieve what we wanted to achieve.
John?
Let me just add to that. When we did the presentation, and it has been a year plus ago, you're absolutely right, but we were asked to just continue on at least with the initial design for phases 1 and 2. And where we need to do some acquisition, we do it, but not to go into construction. So the only construction really we're doing are the tide gates, the sluice gates, and those we're going to need in any case, because that's just preventing things from backing up.
Correct me if I'm wrong, didn't you say that this entire project was going to cost north of $500 million?
Depending on how far you go, it could, yes.
Yeah, so,
and
I mean,
so we're not going all the way there. We're not going all the way there. The last construction we're going to be doing are these tide gates, and we're not proceeding past that with construction. But we want to be postured, because we do think that whatever design we're doing right now will bleed right into the overall fix. And it may not be exactly, we might have to adjust it a little bit, but it will work all together.
It's collection, it's pumping, it's that which we will need if you decide to have a $1 billion gate at the Lynn Haven Inlet.
That's one of the things that
was block it off. You still got to have an internal pumping system, just like any other place that you berm, pond, and pump. This would just be a huge berm if you put a gate at the Lynn Haven Inlet. If you decide sea level rise is sufficient that you just want to shut it off and protect your entire inland waterfront property. The design that they're doing is I think usable. We could sit in a negative or in a no action mode for 2 more years, but we think that the design that we're putting forth is usable
I'm not suggesting no action mode, but what I'm looking at is projects that won't provide relief mm-hmm. to Lynn Haven Colony, which is probably the most impacted of all of them. I mean, because that neighborhood continuously stays outside of any relief absent the gigantic project.
Right.
And when we do this, I know there was some concern that putting in these check valves, things like that, may aggravate flooding conditions for people further down. And so that's a concern of mine. But really, it's just not throw in, you know, good money after bad if we're not going to be able to do this, and a citywide reconnaissance may yield other stories, like maybe we do need to go after this major project. And so as long as what we're doing isn't hurting us on other major projects, that's fine.
Yes, sir. It's really focused on those.
Even what we want to achieve.
Yes, sir. It's focused. this is such a diverse area. It's focused on the internal bowl areas that are collecting that are not contingent to where Lynn Haven Colony waterfront properties are. And short of just shutting off the Lynn Haven, the only solution for them is to elevate them. And we're in the, you heard earlier, as Cheryl briefed, the elevation program and the ability to get grants for severe repetitive loss. When we pursue this fifth grant, we'll be done with all the houses that we can effectively do inside the federal program. We will have raised all the houses that we can economically do under that program. They'll have to change a cost share partnership with homeowners going forward because we can't economically use taxpayer dollars in that program. It's got to be all grant funded, and that's we'll run out of that.
John Walsh.
Piggybacking on Jim just ever so briefly, time is. My concern has been where now you, I think you said flood. This is not stormwater management, which we have a fee. So we're using a fee for a flood control issue, very big, which I look at the opportunity cost of rather dealing. I know I brought this up since I've been on City Council, that this isn't, we cannot finance these projects on the back of the stormwater management fee. And so I think at some point, and it's been like now, I don't know, at least year four, I've said this, but I see no progress. And secondly, 3 years is just too long. I think we need to understand to what extent money compresses time, you know, and to what extent it's the tools we are using that's taking us so much time. Because I think if we don't, we just saw a great tool for modeling highways. I know there's tools for modeling this. We've invested in this digitized database that we have at the city with roads and all this stuff in it. It seems to me like we could move the pace, working with our collaborative partners, finding that modeling software to accelerate the time. Three cycles, that's three hurricane cycles you're dealing with, number one. That's 3 years of opportunity of addressing the problems on the best thing. I think we need to look hard at that answer of why it's 3 years to get that assessment. I'd like to better, but I think we need to start just putting in the appropriation against the fee, what we think we have to do. But I think those other dollars, we need to be figuring out collectively as a body how to finance that and getting that out of the fee structure and just acknowledging that flood control is not stormwater management fee. I think that's going to be a huge dollar value. You can't deduct it off your taxes. We're maximizing the expense through the fee structure. A lot of people don't pay the fee for different reasons or pay less fee, but everybody benefits from flood control like police. So I think if it's not this cycle, Mr. City Manager, it's got to be very soon that we, otherwise we're just $100 million at the oceanfront, $70 million here. There's no way you can put that on the fee structure. It's a right. Fantasy.
So, with the work we're doing now, we're about a year into this study, and that will give us a real good idea of where our vulnerabilities are once we get through that first year. And then we'll follow on with what are the possible adaptation strategies. And it could be in some places we have to berm and pump, and some places it could be we have to elevate homes. It could be in some places we have to say we're not developing there. There's a range of options. I think when we come back, not with this budget, but with next year's budget, we will have some much better information that we can share.
I think, Mr. Mayor, that timeline is too long, and I invite you to take a look. What is holding that up, and what are the barriers, and to what extent can we provide resources to make that happen at a much faster pace?
Good, thank you. All right, let's move on.
Let's move over to the next one. Neighborhood stormwater infrastructure improvements 2. Addresses neighborhood stormwater infrastructure improvements and includes correcting drainage problems in various established neighborhoods and other areas that fall beyond the scope of normal maintenance but do not meet the criteria to stand as a separate CIP project. New projects are added to the needs list each year based on reported flooding problems and field maintenance reports. The current 2 projects are Muddy Creek Road Culvert Improvement Project, which construction should be completed in the next couple of weeks.
The whole about Princess Anne.
And 24th and a half Street Drainage Improvement Project, Muddy Creek. We're still finishing up a little, so.
It's been done.
Thank you.
Good project, yeah.
Thank you, everybody. 24th and a half street drainage improvements project is scheduled to begin construction later this summer, 2016. Northlake Holly Watershed Improvement Project is a multiple outcome project which incorporates sewer and water service upgrades, as well as street renovation and drainage improvements to one of the oldest residential areas in the city. Section 4 is the next section of Northlake Holly Watershed Improvement Project, scheduled to go to construction this summer 2016 and last approximately 16 months. Section 1C and 3 are scheduled to begin construction in 2017. Section 3 is another phase of multiple outcome project. Well, Section 1C includes embankment improvements along North Lake Holly to improve, to help mitigate erosion conditions and add wetlands to satisfy permitting requirements. South Lake Holly Watershed is another one of our multiple outcome projects, which incorporates sewer and water service upgrades, as well as street renovations and drainage improvements to another one of the oldest residential areas in the city. Section 1 and 2 have been under construction since September 2014, and are scheduled to be complete in June 2017. Section 4 is the last phase of the project and is scheduled to begin construction in August 2017. Its construction will be a little over 2 years in length. Southern Canal Lee Ditch and Culvert Improvement Project is for the design and construction of drainage improvements to canal, lee ditches, culverts, and roadways located in the southern watershed. Construction is always timed to minimize inconvenience to the agricultural and residential community, basically due to the length of the detours that have to occur for the projects. Indian Creek Culvert Improvement Project is the current construction project. It is anticipated to be completed mid-April 2016. The Stormwater Modeling Master Planning Analysis and Inventory Project is updating the city's stormwater master plans that were prepared in the late 1980s. Some of its main key components include develop a comprehensive city stormwater management plan and model that fully integrates stormwater quality and quantity control and management. Identify deficiencies in the stormwater management system and alternatives for needed upgrades and improvements. Plan for water quality and quantity needs for the city projects. Plan for sea level rise. Enhance the overall water quality of the sub-basins to meet surface water quality regulatory programs and support the new Virginia DEQ permits and assist the city in annual reporting and other water quality issues. Windsor Wood Drainage. It includes Windsor Woods and Princess Anne Plaza neighborhood. Similar to the Central Resort District and Eastern Shore Drive project, the area experiences flooding during minor to moderate rainfall events. The area is also tidally impacted from the north by the Lynnhaven River via Thalia Creek and London Bridge Canal, as well as from the south via London Bridge Canal due to southerly winds pushing water up the North Landing River and West Neck Creek. The area is located between Holland Road and I-264 and Thalia Creek along the west and London Bridge Canal along the east. Currently, we are studying the drainage issues and developing alternative solutions. This project will be divided into multiple phases, with the first phase including channel improvements and maintenance dredging of Northgate Channel and Windsor Woods Canal. The first phase is currently under design. The drainage improvements will include stormwater pump stations, tide control devices, and storm drain improvements. Early estimates show this project exceeding $40 million in total cost. This project, along with Central Resort District and the Eastern Shore Drive project, plus a future project in the southern section of the city, will be coordinated with the findings and recommendations from the City Sea Level Rise Reoccurrent Flooding Analysis Project. This concludes my portion of the flood control, and I'll turn it back over to Phil Davenport.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Philip.
Okay, we're right there at the end. Just to talk about some of the emerging issues we have that we are not trying to address in this budget cycle. Flood control as projects is much more difficult now than it has been in the past. Permitting requirements are much tougher. The whole construction is much tougher. We've got sea level rise issues that play in, tidal issues that play into it. So, you know, it all is very much more difficult. Our stormwater quality regulations are much more demanding, and we've told you before, but we're going to be back in sometime within the next couple of months and talk about some of those requirements, and some of the numbers that go with that are astounding. So all of our water quality issues are more difficult. That makes all of our operations and maintenance more difficult. So, you know, everything is more difficult now. It's all being compounded with regulations, with permit requirements, with tidal influences, and it's all more than what the capacity of the stormwater utility fund is. Again, we're not looking for money help this year, but it is something we'll have to address as we go in the future years. So with that, if there's any discussion or
any questions
we're
for Phil? We thank you. It was a great presentation.
We've got some really good talent on our team. We have manned up. We've galled up here with some really great professional engineers that you got to see today. I'm comfortable where we're moving. I agree with Mr. Moss. These are huge projects. These are the four watersheds that you brought to the staff 2 years ago in your prioritization. We are addressing those. We do have to get our arms around with our designs to understand what it costs, and we will be having to come back with a financial plan to deal with it. Sir, if I may?
If I could, please.
Yes, sir.
We really enjoy these presentations. Yes. And the roadways we really want to spend some time on. I'd hate to see us fly through that.
We're not going to, sir. I've told the team we're going to put them first next week because that's a good 40-minute brief.
Good.
You all love it. You like to get into it, and there's a lot of charts. We're going to bring economic vitality in right now, and with Brian and Warren, they're going to tee this up, and I think we can get through this and get you out at a reasonable time.
Warren, I thought you weren't going to have to make the presentation, but I guess you got me.
He's not. I think he passed that to Brian again.
Plan.
So,
Brian, you're back up, my friend.
Yes, sir.
We welcome you back.
We're going to move the Windsor Woods up top, right?
Mr. Mayor, members of council, thanks for squeezing me in here with the economic and tourism development projects. Briefing, I'd like to recognize your Economic Development Director, Warren Harris, and then Michelle Chaplot, who are here to support
us
in this briefing.
Here.
So what are we going to go over? And I promise you I'll be as efficient as possible. We're going to go over what the program is. What are some of the recent accomplishments or completed projects from 2015 and 16? Tell you what's fully funded from previous years. Go over what is proposed to be funded in this coming fiscal year with this resource management plan. And then we have a project that is in need of additional funding that was identified in previous years that needs new funding that needs to be identified. And then go over real briefly, touch on some backlog projects, some things that we have on our radar but aren't able to fund at this time but are definitely priorities moving forward. And then I'll summarize briefly some of our points. So coming away from some of your retreats, you've identified these goals related to economic and tourism development for our capital improvement program. They're all here, creating a year-round resort destination. We want to support our military, and we do, and I'll touch on that, but we also want to diversify it as well, and we have some strategies to do that with the biomedical initiative, transit-oriented development, and other opportunities. We want to connect large employment centers to our residents and the transportation program. The briefing you're going to get next week touches on that as well. And then we want to support our business environment in terms of retaining employees as much as we can. We work with a number of departments that forward our economic and tourism development, including agriculture, Convention and Visitors Bureau, cultural affairs, economic development, housing and neighborhood preservation, and planning and community development. Some recent successes there on slide number 4. Is completing Rudy Walk. That had been on the books for over 25 years, and Barry Frankenfield and Dan Adams brought that home, and it's definitely a well-used facility, in effect extending the boardwalk south and east. For the first time, Burton Station residents have water and sewer, and that was completed just recently in terms of the last resident being hooked up with that. Really like to thank Dan Adams and our Public Utilities Department with helping with that effort. We purchased the Atlantic Avenue trolleys, and all 12 will be in service this coming season, and leverage that funding Councilman Wood and Mr. Branch are on the commission representing Virginia Beach at HRT and leverage that with 55% state funding. So the EDIP, Economic Development Investments Program, that your City of Virginia Beach Economic Development Authority manages, these are some of the successes of the past year. And I'd like to thank our friends over in Economic Development for providing us with this information. In the past year, they had 4 awards, retained 102 jobs, and also created 144 more. And based on that $345,000 investment, yielded $4.2 million in capital investment on the private side. The APZ1 awards, and Warren communicated to me, there'll be a big announcement next week on a new one coming out. In that program of Yes Oceana, created $13.9 million worth of capital investment off of $260,000 EDIP awards. Speaking of Yes Oceana, in terms of the APZ1 program, and coming away from the 2005 BRAC order, and Mr. Mayor and others have led that effort in a nationally acclaimed program to reduce density around NES Oceana and our special economic growth areas, but yet increase the fiscally positive uses, light industrial uses that are around that area that are more compatible. All of these acquisitions, and I compliment Mark Stiles' staff and Becky Kubin and numerous staff that have worked on that, have all been willing sellers. Another completed project, and one that helped create Mr. Hansen's recommendation to you last March, is the transit corridor development CIP that helped identify in the bottom right there the quarter mile and half mile walk sheds that helped us identify the 2 stations that would serve the Pembroke strategic growth area in addition to the Wichtuck station. If I could, there we go. This is a map on slide 8 of a distribution of all of the CIP projects. And you can see they're really focused around NES Oceana, Princess Anne Commons, which is a special economic growth areas, and then, of course, your SGAs, which is in accordance with your comprehensive plan in terms of your investment, aligning capital improvement program with planned land use. Here's an overview of the program. So there's 17 programs proposed in the Economic Tourism Development CIP for next fiscal year at about $35.7 million. One project, which is Winston-Salem Avenue, requires an additional $4.715 million to move forward. And then we have some high-priority projects for us, but ones that are not likely to be in the city manager's recommended budget, but are definitely priority projects moving forward. Virginia Beach Bio is one. We'll get the timing right on that. And the others are improvements to help the Pembroke strategic growth area continue to grow as your central business district. Some of the projects fully funded that we continue to work on is Historic Kempsville. I believe Clay Burnick is going to work with Dr. Ross Hammond and with support from our office to employ some signage there. We're also looking at everything from bus shelters to other uses to help economic development and those 4 corridors of developing those quadrants there. Arena infrastructure development, on-site improvements, 19th Street corridor, and the 29th Street improvements in the oceanfront SGA. So these are all projects that are proposed within budget, and a couple that I'd like to, and these are only year one funding, so you may have additional funding that's in out years, but a couple I'd like to bring to your attention, I will on some further slides, is actually the majority of your off-site arena infrastructure is to be programmed and funded this fiscal year. I'll go over a couple new ones I wanted to kind of emphasize on here in a second. Winston-Salem, we're about halfway through design on that, and when you go and you look at undergrounding utilities and really creating a corridor that's even more pedestrian-friendly than even what we're trying to do at Pacific Avenue, it does have an increased cost, and what we propose to do is continue with design, maybe do some utility relocation, but to delay construction on that till 2018, and then reprioritize funding towards the Vibe, which I'll go over here in a second. Burton Station Phase 1 and 3, and then these are kind of graphics that are a little bit hard to see, but Mr. Hansen's briefed you on these in the past, most recently in January. And so the master plan, if you're looking at the Northampton Boulevard corridor and I-64 here, this is Burton Station Road here. So phase one would be coming in off of North Hampton Boulevard here, and then branching off here and here, and then phase three would be going north. And so you may say, well, what happened to phase two? Phase two would be this ring road that would help to serve the, what's called the Burton Station Village. And if you look at this map, the red circle, basically phase one of Burton Station Road would be coming here and here, serve the existing residents that are here, also Tranquility, which is an affordable housing development, and then the apartments that we've, multifamily opportunities that we briefed you on right here by the lake, which we're trying to work with to accommodate the stormwater from the development of this area here. And then, of course, we'll be working with the Norfolk Airport Authority, and we'll be coming to you in the coming months to rezone the Norfolk Airport Authority property. London Bridge Commerce Center, it's an exciting opportunity. It was a site acquired through your APZ One program, and I'd like to thank Michelle for managing that program in concert with others. But it's an opportunity to really start to develop a business park. And what this project does is creates a road going in and extends utilities to serve various parcels where we can relocate existing businesses in the city that are currently in incompatible areas, or attract new businesses to relocate and align the compatibility of those uses with an NES Oceana operations. And so we're looking to fund about $1.3 million in year one, and the total program is about $2.1 million. The Vibe District, looking to fund about $1.5 million in the coming year. And what that does is to create a core set of improvements to make it the area more pedestrian-friendly, to mirror some of the private investment that's already occurred out there with restaurants and art studios. But this is 19th Street here. 18th Street's really the heart of the Vibe itself. And there's a parklet there, some excess right-of-way that we're looking to create, perhaps somewhere where the farmer's market could go in the future and hold other events. On this corner here is where they often hold outdoor music events. And so we're looking at improving the crosswalks, piping some ditches, and adding wide sidewalks and shared use pathways in the Cypress Avenue, 18th Street, 17th Street, and Mediterranean Avenue corridor with this project. So that would help with design and construction of those, and working with our friends in Public Works.
Yes, sir. Just so you know, we had a big meeting today, and I issued some guidance to the team of how we take on this immediate first step. And our focus is going to be sidewalks and LED pedestrian lighting on this stretch and 18th Street to this stretch. And if we can get that in for $1.5 million, I think you're going to be really amazed. We have a lot more right-of-way, the cross-section of right-of-way, than I even knew about, having walked those streets and looked at it. We got a great opportunity to make a big dent in the initiatives that you all expressed at the goal-setting retreat.
Well, it sure would be nicer than walking into a ditch.
So
the new street maps on the boardwalk, I don't know if that's what you're planning on using.
Something very similar to that, maybe not. Those are the most expensive out there.
I was going to say, the neighbors down there love those.
Oh,
lights.
Yeah. Those by heart. The ones we're looking at are probably more in line with, as you drive home tonight and you look along PA4 and you see it's the same lantern style, open in the middle, LEDs. And what they do is they have an ability to arc their light like this. So this reflects against the close fascia of apartment buildings and there, and then this will cast out into the street and get, you know, on street parking. So when you park your car, you're getting out, you're underneath the ped light, widened 10-foot street, sidewalks on one side, probably 6 feet on the other side. Great opportunity to step out and do what I think you all wanted us to do with a minimal amount of effort. The 17th Street efforts that people want to tackle, we got a real rat's nest of distribution lines in the air and other things. I don't think we get to that right off the bat, so I don't want people to get all excited about 17th Street. I think it's going to take more, and we need to get into the arena and see how we progress on that project, see if I can harvest
or that we can produce the arena and save some money and then come back to you and say, we ought to continue on with whatever residue we have there in this area.
Are you suggesting not even a pilot project?
Well, the pilot project is a discussion that needs to go down, but you can see the appropriations that we've been able to put together in the upcoming budget. We're kind of getting out ahead of the 22nd, but that's about all I can carve out right now. But it's still listen to what you said, give you a long program. A pilot, in my mind, and what developers think a pilot are two different things.
I think what people are thinking of is like Atlantic Avenue.
Oh.
And I think Atlantic Avenue was, the pilot was, what, five blocks. I think they're talking something like two blocks. I don't know.
And,
I just passed.
And if we put a $10 million plug in here where I can underground utilities and step up to the plate, then I'm game for that. What I'm dealing with is $1.5 million to be able to get out there and create the heart of the vibe, step out, move expeditiously forward, which is the expectation, I think, of the district, and be able to create sidewalks, ADA-compliant crossings, and ped lights for pedestrian safety. And there's some very major development projects that are going in there that we're going to be able to cost share with partners, with developers that are willing to step up. And if they're going to build a 5-foot sidewalk, we'll pay for the another 5 feet and to give us that ability and put the LED in.
Yep.
So we got some good initiatives
good
going
deal.
In there. I didn't mean to step on
that. Yes, sir. Absolutely. Thanks for the emphasis. And winding down, just like to thank Barry Frankenfield and Phil Davenport. This is his CIP that we're rotating forward. And Mr. Davenport and his staff for helping us to actually implement and do the heavy lifting with all these projects. And, of course, Catherine Whitesell and her staff for helping us pull together the right numbers and keeping us straight in that regard. And winding down, of course, we all come under Deputy City Manager Doug Smith. Trying to align our CIP, and we hope you feel that we've done that with your priorities. And down at the bottom, we have an economic vitality strategic issue team that meets with all your directors, CVB, finance, economic development, and others. These are our priorities that came away from it. We're able to fund three of the four, with the Virginia Beach Bio hopefully being on deck soon. So I'll stand by for any questions you might have.
Well, we certainly thank you. Any questions, Council? Great timing. Sorry we had to push Phil back, but I think it'd be worth it. We really enjoy that presentation. All these presentations have been great. We thank you all. Thanks for everyone. Yes, ma'am.
I have something to
okay.
And just one quick notebook management. This is your notebook for the whole process going forward into the budget. If you want us to keep them for you, leave them here. If you want to take them home, take them home. We'll add PowerPoints through your packet process.
Rosemary.
Yes. I wanted to bring up that there are at least four of us here that are recommending a light rail referendum question. And before I pass it out, I just kind of, and there's a reason I'm going to do this, I want to read the one done in 2012, because I think it's important when we had that one to have a link to the next question. There needs to be some continuity. And it was, should the City Council adopt an ordinance approving the use of all reasonable efforts to support the financing and development of the light rail into Virginia Beach? And I think that's a pretty clear question, and a lot of people say it's not. However, there is one word that is very subjective, and that word is reasonable. So, and the problem that we have is that we don't know what light rail is going to cost. That's we're not going to know for a year at least. But we're all concerned about what the price tag might be. And I think that $310 million that HRT says is, I'm not sure there's anybody in this council that would support that, because it's so far out of line. So this question, and I'll read it, I think it frames reasonable the best that we can, considering we still don't know what it's going to cost. And we're trying to keep it very, very simple. Should the City Council adopt an ordinance approving construction of an extension of light rail to Virginia Beach Town Center if the cost of construction operation will not require any additional tax increase? We really still care about what the voters think. And we want their opinion.
we asked it in 2012, and again, we know more now than we did, and our citizens really do care about this issue. We hear about it every day. And even though I think the question was clear, there was confusion in the marketing. And I know a lot of people who have told me that they thought they were voting for a study. So I think people need another chance to vote on it. This is the best that we could figure out how to define reasonable, because we don't know what that price is. Shannon, Jim, John Earn, and myself and Bobby, and I want to thank Bobby for joining us. We are co-sponsoring this.
All right, so
Mark has told me that if anybody else would like to co-sponsor it with us,
before next week.
He needs to know by tomorrow.
By tomorrow afternoon. Wanted to be included.
You're planning on bringing
this
next Tuesday, correct?
It's going to be on the agenda for next week.
Okay, John and then Bobby.
Well, I will not be supporting it. I think we probably will have filed our paperwork with the voter registrar before that. The people, I think, I don't want to have two questions on the ballot, and I think we work for the citizens, and if they've met the threshold, and at the last minute, because we're disappointed that they met the threshold, that we then want to pose a different question than what almost 30,000 people have signed, I think our deference should be to those 30,000 citizens and not to a question that they get on Friday to think about and then come down here on Tuesday night to give us our opinion before we vote. I just think that I'm sure the intentions are well, but I think the appearance would be it's disingenuous.
Bobby.
Yeah, thank you. And I really do appreciate Mr. Moss's comments, but, you know, if I can remind folks that I brought this initiative forward, I believe, back in early December. And this was something that was on my mind. And, yes, there was in my mind and the feedback I got from the public that, you know, the first question was not only, you know, a tad confusing or anything, but there is far more information now that we could use to build a value decision on. Things are moving forward in that regard. And, it's the type of thing. You know, when I first brought this forward, I encouraged participation from other council members, you know, to participate in the question and try to build some consensus. And I think one of the objectives, and I know my objectives, and I think in knowing the objectives of many of the council people that sit at this table, that we have found new value in civic engagement. It worked with the arena. It worked with the strategic growth area projects. I tell you, work very well with our police departments, neighborhood policing, by inclusion of, you know, this politics of inclusion about bringing the people together. And the thing is, whether it be, Mr. Atkinson's, I respect his initiative, but as I said before, where I come from, I launched this a while ago and bringing it forward, and I'm willing to, you know, negotiate, you know, to build consensus on this council. And I think that, you know, the public needs a council-driven thing, initiative to show that, you know, that we are, you know, we value their opinion. And their opinion would be a valuable tool in our decision-making process going forward. And the other thing I'm hoping is that this does provoke the much-needed discussion that we have to have on light rail, but not only light rail, but what happens if it's not light rail. What about other options? You know, and the thing is, we are far too divisive right now. This is a polarizing, subject out there in the public. Can't we build bridges? Can't we find common ground? Can't we all agree that we need a transportation solution? My thing, I'm sorry, I'm going to maintain it's not light rail. But, you know, the thing is, let's have the discussion and, you know, bring it forward and, you know, show that, you know, council's taking the initiative.
Very good, then. Yes,
sir. I will take at least 20 to 30 minutes on Tuesday night of that voting thing to make a comprehensive historical presentation, including some videos from people who've spoken on this issue. So I just want to make sure that no one thinks we're leaving extra early on Tuesday night.
But, well, first of all, I'm glad this has been presented. You know, I think two things. And we're going to get out of here. I'll be real quick. I hope we all agree that there are wonderful people on each side of this. You know, I mean, I think let's the polarizing thing is something that's terribly troubling to me, Bob. And you hit the nail on the head. We've got people that want a referendum that don't want a referendum. And, I mean, people we all know on both sides, and they're very, very fine people. We have no people that want light rail and don't want light rail. Again, very fine people on both sides. I do think we're going to run into an issue, though, if we have two questions. And I reached out to Mr. Agassiz with Rosemary's okay, and Jim was okay just a few minutes before the start of the meeting. And, frankly, he had reached out to me while I was on vacation, thank you very much, seeing if we would be interested in doing a resolution as a body. Anyway, if there's going to be a referendum, I would suggest that there only be one question on it for everyone's benefit, you know. So, anyway, yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry, I'm going to stop you and say one more thing. If okay.
Please.
You know, I've done my own poll as I've gone the past 3 years asking people, do you want light rail, do you not want light rail? And you're right, it's truly a divided city, 50-50, pretty much down the middle.
5 points either way.
You know, you go to Walmart, you go to Harris Teeter, you go to wherever, and I'm having dinner at places, and I'll randomly go up to people and just ask them. And it really is a 50-50 split. But the one thing that's a recurring theme is that group of people that say, well, I don't know. How much is it going to cost? And so I think as opposed to saying, do you want this, yes or no, this question at least gives some type of ceiling or parameter that gives that person that really wants to contemplate yes or no and really give an honest answer the right to give that answer with some substance to the question. And so
great
that's
point.
Why I'm supporting that. And I think that's where either side could gain or lose a few votes along the way, but that's I think it's going to help the vote.
Good point. Good point. Well, thank you all very much for your time. Have a wonderful evening, and I look forward to